Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. We would like to inform you that the Shankar IAS Academy has started admissions for the third test batch for pre-storming 2021, that is the prelims test series for upcoming prelims 2021. Shankar IAS Academy's pre-storming prelims test series is India's first full-fledged artificial intelligence supported preliminary test series. The test will commence from 8th January 2021. These are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis, and their page number in different editions are given here. The links for the handwritten notes in PDF format and timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description and also in the comments section. This news article states that the execution record of Veerapandiya Kattabomman is to be digitized. In the context of analyzing this news article, let us see the news then about Kattabomman. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, Veerapandiya Kattabomman is one of the early fighters against British rule, and he was remembered recently on his birth anniversary, which is observed on January 3rd. Kattabomman was hanged by the British in October 1799. On the very next day of his death, a report titled Kattabomman Naik was prepared by John Bannerman of English East India Company. John Bannerman led the force to take on Kattabomman. In the report, Bannerman had high praise to Kattabomman. It is written in cursive style and was sent to Edward Clive. The news article states that this report is to be digitized soon. See, the earliest expressions of opposition to British rule took the form of localized rebellions and uprisings in Tamil Nadu. One of the main revolts among these was the revolt of Palayakars against the East India Company. Palayakarers were also called as Paligars. Now let us see what the Palayakar system is. Palayakarar system evolved in Tamil Nadu with the extension of Vijayanagar rule into Tamil Nadu. Each Palayakarar was the holder of a territory or a palayam which was granted in return for military service and tribute. A palayam usually consists of a few villages. History books note that in most cases, the Palayakarars gave little attention to perform their duties and they were interested in increasing only their own powers. With their numerical strength, extensive resources, local influence and independent attitude, they came to constitute a powerful force in the political system of South India. They regarded themselves as independent, sovereign authorities within their respective palayams. They argued that their lands had been handed down to them across a span of 60 generations. However, such claims were brushed aside by the East India Company. Among the Palayakarars, there were two blocks. One was led by Pulithevan of Nerkattum Seval. The other was led by Veerapandiya Kattabomman of Panjalam Kurichi. Today, let us focus only on Kattabomman. Kattabomman became Palayakarar at the age of 30 on the death of his father. During his time, the company administrators considered him as a man without education and as a man of peaceful disposition. However, several events led to conflict between Kattabomman and East India Company. Mainly, the collection of tribute served as a cause of friction between him and collector Jackson. Jackson was arrogant against Kattabomman and attempted to humiliate Kattabomman several times. This matter was, however, settled by the intervention of Madras Company government. Jackson was finally dismissed from service. A popular slogan of Kattabomman is, "It rains and the land yields. Then why should we pay tax to the English?" Despite the temporary settlement of matters, the humiliation suffered by Kattabomman affected his self-respect. In August 1798, the son of the Palayakarar of Sivagiri and his advisor visited Panchalam Kurichi and held consultations. Kattabomman decided to establish his influence in Sivagiri with the aid of the son of Palayakarar. According to the company, the Palayakarar of Sivagiri was a tributary to the company. Therefore, the Madras Company Council considered this move as a challenge to its authority and ordered war against Kattabomman. Major Bannerman, who was armed with extensive powers, assumed the command of the expedition. Bannerman asked Kattabomman to surrender soon. He considered Kattabomman as evasive and decided on military action. In due course of military action, Kattabomman escaped to Pudukkottai. However, the ruler of Pudukkottai captured Kattabomman from the jungles and handed him over to the British. On 16th October 1799, Veerapandiyan was tried before an assembly of Palayakarars at Kayathar and Bannerman announced death penalty to Kattabomman. On the next day, he was hanged to death. His fight against the British inspired his followers and fellow Palayakarars. The fight of Kattabomman forms part of first Palayakkara rebellion or Palayagar rebellion in Tamil Nadu. So, from prelims point of view, we should know who are the Palayagars, what is their relationship with regard to Vijayanagar Empire. So, from prelims point of view, we should know other rebellions that took place in southern India, such as the Kittur Uprising, which was led by Rani Chinnamma, and the revolt by Velu Thampi of Trivankur, who was the Diwan of Trivankur. So, from prelims point of view, we should see all these uprisings that took place in the southern part of India. Now, let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with reference to the implementation of Article 244A of the Indian Constitution. The news is that a group of lawmakers from Assam has submitted a memorandum to the center seeking the implementation of Article 244A for the creation of an autonomous state within Assam. So, from prelims point of view, we should know what Article 244A is and for what it was brought into the Constitution. Now, let us see that. See, Northeast Indian states have been reorganized multiple times since independence. In 1969, the reorganization process was carried out, but few areas in Assam were not reorganized completely. And for this process, an Article 244A was introduced with the Constitution 22nd Amendment Act 1969. Article 244A prescribes the formation of an autonomous state comprising certain tribal areas of Assam. It also provides for creation of local legislature or council of ministers or both. To implement this, Parliament has to bring a legislation according to the Constitution. Though this article was introduced as back as in 1969, it hasn't been implemented even today. So, there has been a demand across three hill districts of Karbi Anglong, West Karbi Anglong and Dima Hasaw for forming an autonomous state within Assam as outlined in Article 244A. Currently, these districts are governed by two autonomous councils, that is Dima Hasaw Autonomous District Council for Dima Hasaw District, Karbi Anglong Autonomous District Council for Karbi Anglong and West Karbi Anglong districts. These autonomous councils are constituted under the provisions of 6th schedule of the Constitution. So, from prelims point of view, we should know what are the district councils and where these district councils are present, that is in which states these district councils are present, and how does 6th schedule of the Constitution apply to these states and these councils. This is all that you should know about in this article, and this is what you should know about Article 244A. Now, let us move on to the next article, the quagmire that is Brexit. The article talks about the issues associated with Brexit, that is Britain's exit from the European Union. On December 26, 2020 Hindu News Analysis, we have discussed in detail about Brexit and the reasons behind it. Today, let us see the points given by the author regarding the issues in it. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. The UK or Britain voted to leave the European Union in 2016 and officially left the European Union on 31st January 2020. And transition period till December 31, 2020 was agreed because of the UK-European Union negotiations were taking place. This was done to determine what the future relationship between them will eventually be. There was fear that Britain might exit without a trade deal, as till November 2020, no deal was signed. Finally, in December, only a week before the end of transition period, a Brexit trade deal was signed. The deal contains new rules for how the UK and European Union will live, work and trade together. This deal attracted favorable attention by the British PM Boris Johnson, who felt victorious. But the author feels that there are many issues around the deal. Mainly, there are issues in how it was executed. That is, the author feels that the deal was rushed. Just before the end of transition period, the deal was signed hastily. So, a meaningful deliberation or discussion could not be carried out. Also, Brexit may have been used to conceal the real problems of Britain, which include deindustrialization and the loss of manufacturing. There has been a decrease in the amount of manufacturing that is taking place in Britain. Traditional industries such as shipbuilding and textiles have declined. But there is a growth in tertiary and quaternary sectors, especially the services and the financial sector. Currently, service sector makes up about 3/4 of the UK economy. Then, there was also very low funding on the public services, and only after the pandemic started, the funding has increased. So, now what are the expected effects of such a deal? According to the author, the British will realize that they have gotten the deal at a great cost. Because if you see why UK came out of European Union, it is to be an independent island state with its sovereignty intact. But what is the use of such sovereignty? No one knows. This is what the author tells. But according to the ongoing trade negotiations of the United Kingdom with other countries, we can say Britain is doing something on the trade front. See, since UK is no longer in the European Union, it is free to set its own trade policy and can negotiate deals with other countries. Thus, talks are being held with countries that currently don't have free trade deals with European Union, such as USA, Australia, etc. The next effect could be breakup of Britain. As you know, UK comprises of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. Here, Great Britain includes England, Wales and Scotland. See, English nationalism was one of the reasons for Brexit. So, this has triggered nationalistic tendencies in other parts of UK also. For example, the political scenario in Scotland has changed. During 2014, a referendum to leave UK was held. But majority supported Scotland and wanted Scotland to be a part of UK. But now, after Brexit, there is more support for Scottish Nationalist Party, which advocates for Scotland leaving the United Kingdom. So if another referendum is held, then the tide might be against being part of the United Kingdom. Next, the deal has put Northern Ireland in a much more insecure and untenable or weak position. See, as part of the deal, United Kingdom and European Union have agreed that checks will not take place at the border between Northern Ireland and Republic of Ireland. So, Northern Ireland will continue to follow many of European Union's rules, which means lorries, trucks can continue to drive across the Ireland or Northern Ireland border without being inspected. But there will be a new regulatory border between Northern Ireland and Great Britain because unlike Northern Ireland, Great Britain does not have to follow European Union rules in the future. This means some checks on goods moving between Great Britain and Northern Ireland is needed. These checks have already started creating problems in the supply chain. It has been reported that Northern Ireland is facing disruptions to its food supply because suppliers in Great Britain are unaware of the Brexit-related paperwork needed to send goods to the region. This is causing delays in arrival of consignments. The next effect is due to the fact that hard versions of Brexit has been chosen by UK government according to the author. This hard version favors to create a deregulated low-tax economy. This is because the current ruling party of UK, the Conservative Party, is Thatcherite. That is, they are supporters of political and economic policies of former British Conservative Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. Her policies involved privatization of nationalized industries, low taxation by cutting income tax, and strict trade union legislations, etc. But such policies will create greater conflict with European Union as it is regulation friendly. This is due to European Union's economic neoliberalism known as German Ordoliberalism. Ordoliberalism was developed in Germany under Nazi rule. Ordoliberalism wishes to promote the decentralized coordination of economic activities within a framework of rules and regulation in opposition to any form of centralizing state intervention. At the same time, it grants major role to public authorities in designing and transforming these rules and regulations. This ordoliberalism creates economics rules-based orthodoxy in European Union and makes European Union rigid. So, as a result, the author predicts that European Union will view United Kingdom as a competitor, which in turn will lead to an increase in tariff barriers. So, the author concludes by saying that both United Kingdom and European Union should leave their own strict ideologies to have a future that is free of conflict. This is all about Brexit and the repercussions that United Kingdom is going to have because of Brexit. Let us now move on to the next article. This is Data Point. This data point presents data related to studies that suggest that SARS-CoV-2 VUI 2020-12-01 or the UK strain of the novel coronavirus could be 50-75% more transmissible than the usual or older variants. This study was conducted by London's Imperial College. Remember that on 14th December 2020, authorities of the United Kingdom reported to World Health Organization that a new SARS-CoV-2 variant was identified through viral genomic sequencing. This variant is referred to as SARS-CoV-2 VUI 2020-12-01. The full form for this is Variant Under Investigation Year 2020 Month 12 Variant 01. Now, the report says that the R value of the new variant of coronavirus increases by 50-75% compared to the usual or older variant. Here, R value means an expression of the change or effect produced by the variation in certain variables or of the ratio between two variables. Here, in case of disease like COVID-19, when we refer to R number, it is a way of rating the virus or any disease ability to spread. R is the number of people that one infected person will pass on the infection to another person. As you can see in the first graph, the number of new cases in Canada's Alberta province would triple from 1,000 to 3,000 cases in 14 days, with R value increasing to 60%. This compared to the older R value, where the cases would halve to 500 from 1,000 in 2 weeks' time. Now, the report also says that due to the new variant's high transmissibility, UK registered world's highest number of cases between December 30, 2020 and January 5, 2021. You can see this in the second graph. See, talking about transmissibility, in medicine, transmissibility means the quality of a disease being able to be passed down from one person or organism to another. Now let us see about the new strain in our country. Around 71 cases of infection with new variant was reported in India as of January 5, 2020. In this information, around 71 cases of infection with new variant was reported in India as of January 5, 2020. However, this information is available only with respect to some states. So far, Karnataka has registered 11 cases of the new variant, followed by Maharashtra 8, Delhi 7 cases and Kerala 6 cases. More data on the state-wise split is expected. But what we should know from this data is that the new strain, that is the UK strain, has higher transmission rate than the older strain. This can be asked as a question in prelims. Now, let us move on to the next article, Boosting India with Maritime Domain Awareness. Here, the author talks about India's initiatives to improve our capabilities in maritime domain. So let us see them in detail. The syllabus here is given for your reference. We all know that the geostrategic position of the Indian Ocean region has risen in economic and political significance in the last 2 decades. And we are witnessing a tectonic shift in international power play from the Atlantic Ocean to the Asia, more specifically to the Indian Ocean region. There is a growing maritime awareness in the Indian Ocean region as most developmental indices of the littorals are closely linked to the ocean. Here, littorals mean countries that are bordering the Indian Ocean. We also know that the Indian Ocean is faced with a wide spectrum of traditional, non-traditional and transnational security challenges. India's biggest challenge is to deal with an aggressive China. We know that China's long-term strategic intent is to dominate the Indian Ocean. Its ultimate goal is that of displacing the USA as the global superpower. Its ambitious Belt and Road Initiative has put many of the countries in India's neighborhood into a debt trap which they are unable to come out from. Also, we are facing a major security threat due to the aggressive naval presence of China in the region. So, countering these effectively in the vast expanse of the ocean requires collective and inclusive security architecture with other countries in the region. In this regard, India, being the largest power in the Indian Ocean and a net security provider in the region, has an opportunity or potential to lead in developing this construct to secure not only strategic interest but also those of other countries in its maritime neighborhood. Consequently, India gives due importance to the seas by building adequate infrastructure so that we can realize our economic and political potential and protect ourselves from enemies. This is what the author tries to stress in this article. He starts by quoting a legendary military theorist who said that the critical element in battle was foreknowledge, but that it could not be elicited from spirits, nor from gods, nor by analogy with past events, nor from calculations. Here, he means to tell that the foreknowledge or information about enemy's plans could only be gathered with specialized tools and by men who knew the enemy well. A prior reading of the adversary and the theater of battle could decisively shift the balance of fortune in the war. This is what the tactician was trying to tell. So, in this regard, the Indian government is working on upgrading our naval strength through various initiatives and technological supports. We will see them as discussed in this article. First, the author talks about radar stations set up by Indian Navy in Maldives, Myanmar, and Bangladesh. This is aimed at expanding India's surveillance footprint in the Indian Ocean region. The author also notes that Mauritius, Seychelles, and Sri Lanka have already integrated into the wider coastal radar chain network. This is to address our concerns, particularly in the seas around Andaman and Nicobar Islands, where Chinese presence is frequently reported. We all know about the Chinese aggression in the South China Sea and how it is giving trouble to the states surrounding South China Sea. Second, he tells how India's maritime domain awareness is generating enthusiasm amongst our neighbors to cooperate with us. Seven Indian Ocean countries, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, the Maldives, Mauritius, and the Seychelles, will soon post liaison officers at Indian Navy's Information Fusion Center, Indian Ocean Region, that is IFC-IOR, in Gurugram. In this regard, know that France already has an officer at IFC, and four other Indo-Pacific navies, Australia, Japan, UK, and the US, have also agreed to position officers at the center. Now, we'll see what Information Fusion Center, Indian Ocean Region is. This is an initiative started by the Indian Navy and supported by the government of India. It was set up in 2018 in Gurugram, Haryana, as an information sharing hub of maritime data. The center was set up as a line of action for responses to maritime security situations through a collaborative approach. It is administering a website to undertake the collection and dissemination of information on a daily basis, and it also hosts the monthly maritime security update, which highlights and analyzes the incidents, warnings, and advisories issued in the Indian Ocean region. Moreover, it is actively interacting with maritime community and has already built linkages with 18 countries and 15 multinational maritime security centers. Third, the author talks about India's engagement in the Western Indian Ocean. In this regard, our government has positioned a liaison officer at the Regional Maritime Information Futures Center, which is present in Madagascar. See, we should know what the functions of RMFIC, that is Regional Maritime Information Futures Center, is, because questions like this are very important from prelims perspective. See, the RMFIC functions under the aegis of Indian Ocean Commission, of which India became an observer in March 2020 along with Japan and the United Nations. It is based in Madagascar, and it is designed to deepen maritime domain awareness by monitoring maritime activities and promoting information sharing and exchange. In a similar manner, India has also posted an officer at the European Maritime Awareness in the Strait of Hormuz in Abu Dhabi to assist in the monitoring of maritime activity in the Persian Gulf and the Strait of Hormuz. See, EMASOH is an 8 European country maritime security initiative. Its headquarters is composed of Belgium, Denmark, the Netherlands, and French officers, and it is based at the French naval base in Abu Dhabi. It was started by the French in February 2020. Its objective is to promote safe transit and freedom of navigation for merchant shipping in the Gulf, Strait of Hormuz, and Gulf of Oman. Third, the author talks about the Indian Navy P-8I aircrafts, which are intended for the surveillance of Bay of Bengal and its littorals. See, the P-8I surveillance aircraft is a variant of Boeing's P-8A Poseidon aircraft, which It had developed as a replacement to the US Navy's aging P-3 fleet. It is equipped for intelligence, surveillance, anti-surface warfare, long-range anti-submarine warfare, and reconnaissance in support of the broad area maritime and littoral operations. It has exceptional maritime surveillance and reconnaissance capabilities. The aircraft has high speed and high endurance of about 10 hours. It is capable of thrusting a punitive response and maintaining a watch over India's immediate and extended areas of interest. In this regard, we should know that the Indian Navy has 9 operational P-80 aircraft with 9 more aircraft planned to be inducted. Fourth, he talks about India's military satellite GSAT-7A, which may soon facilitate a real-time sharing of maritime information with partners. See, GSAT-7A is one of India's most advanced military satellites. It was launched by Indian Space Research Organization. The satellite is built to provide communication capability to the users in KU band over the Indian region. It will be used by the Indian Air Force and the Indian Army, and it is modeled on the GSAT-7 satellite built for the Indian Navy. An advanced Gregorian antenna has been used in the satellite to improve its performance. Finally, the author tells that all these initiatives are a part of the Sagar. Sagar means security and growth for all in the region. This term was coined by our Prime Minister in 2015 during his Mauritius visit with a focus on the blue economy. This Sagar is a maritime initiative which gives priority to the Indian Ocean region for ensuring peace, stability and prosperity of India in the Indian Ocean region. The goal is to seek a climate of trust and transparency, respect for international maritime rules and norms by all countries, sensitivity to each other's interest, peaceful resolution of maritime issues, and increase in maritime cooperation. It is in line with the principles of Indian Ocean Rim Association. This is all about this article. This is very important from both prelims and mains point of view. We have now come to the last part of the session, practice questions. Now look at this question. Consider the following statements with reference to Veerapandiya Kattabomman. The first statement, he was a polygar who owed allegiance to the Vijayanagar Empire. Polygars were feudatories who controlled group of villages known as Palayam. Which of the above given statements is or are correct? The right answer is option C, both 1 and 2. As we saw in the article, Veerapandiya Kattabomman was a polygar. And who were polygars? Polygars were chieftains who owed allegiance to the Vijayanagar Empire. They were feudatories. That is, they paid tributes to the Vijayanagar king who was ruling the Vijayanagar Empire. And they were controlling small group of villages known as Palayam. So, both the options are correct. Now, let us move on to the next practice question. Look at this statement. With reference to Information Fusion Center, Indian Ocean region, consider the following statements. It was set up in Madagascar as an information sharing hub of maritime data by the Indian Navy. It hosts the monthly maritime security update, highlighting analysis on incidents, warnings, and advisories issued in the Indian Ocean region. Which of the above statements is or are incorrect? Look at this, it says incorrect. So, as we know, first statement is incorrect and second statement is correct. First statement is incorrect because IFC-IOR was an initiative started by the Indian Navy and supported by the Government of India. It was set up in 2018 in Gurugram, Haryana as an information sharing hub of maritime data. But in option it is given, it was set up in Madagascar. What was set up in Madagascar? We have discussed in the article. The Regional Maritime Information Future Center is present in Madagascar. It functions under Indian Ocean Commission. In this Indian Ocean Commission, India is an observer. So this is what you should know. Now let us see the next question. Which of the following best describes the term or value sometimes seen in news? The first option, it is an expression of change or effect produced by variation in certain variables. B, it is an expression which shows the rate of inflation with the rate of unemployment. It is used to illustrate an economic theory which suggests that there is a level of government spending that maximizes economic growth. And the final option, it is a measure of the distribution of resources across a population. The correct answer is option A. It is an expression of the changes or effect produced by the variation in certain variables. Option B refers to Phillips curve and option C refers to Rahn curve. Now let us move on to the next question. Now the next question is a mains question. Now let us read the question. Present an account of the Brexit and examine its implication on United Kingdom and European Union. So with regard to Brexit, you can always expect mains question from it. So how will you answer this question? First, give a brief introduction about Brexit. Explain what Brexit is. And since it is a 15 marker, you should definitely give 15 points. We have discussed many points about what are the implications. You can list them one by one. You can talk about economic front. You can talk about social front, how there will be increasing nationalism and how there will be breakup of United Kingdom. Like that, you can cover different aspects. And finally, you can conclude by giving a way forward. You can tell what future course of action both United Kingdom and European Union can take. Let us see the next practice mains question. India's emerging capabilities suggest a regional and local superiority over the Chinese PLAN in the Indian Ocean region. In the light of the above statement, list out various initiatives of the Government of India with respect to technological upgradation and regional cooperation in the maritime domain. So you can write answers for these two questions and you can post it in the comment section. With this, we come to the end of today's Hindu news analysis. If you like the video, please do click the like button, comment and share it among your friends who are in need of such resources. And please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content for civil service preparations. Thank you.